Welcome back to the last session. This is the e-studio lab which Sajjan heads, where our lectures are being recorded and post recording editing facilities are there. And the other is a mini cloud hardware. It's a very small lab. There's nothing much to see. There are racks and some hardware, but that is the kind of infrastructure that we have created. Or perhaps what we could do is, Sajjan, we could take photographs and make a small video of these lab facility. Those of you are interested are still welcome to visit them, but those are primarily important from the point of view of creating MOOCs and from the point of view of running MOOCs on a hardware infrastructure. The software is IIT Bombay X, as I said. Last year, when our project for developing Indian open source platform was approved and we had said about this Section 8 company and other things, there was a time when we were asked to start working on Swayam. At that time, I had suggested to the ministry that if you want multiple universities and institutions to prepare, design MOOCs and operate them, then all of them should be given this facility and infrastructure, a small video editing studio and a small server to run the things as an experiment in their own institutions. I had suggested a grant of a crore of rupees for equipment to each of the institutions and a similar amount for 3 years for personnel and so on. At that point in time, the ministry appeared very positive. So we actually conducted training sessions for about 20 teachers from multiple central universities on how to create such MOOCs courses and run them. We also ran that workshop for school teachers later. Somehow, the decision about Swayam, its launch, its operations, has been taken out of the ambit, and now there are government committees which are working on it. I hope some solution will come. There is a costing committee, there are multiple committees. Actually, if you ask me personally, I get a bit worried. I call it the committology. That means if you commit an issue to committees, the resolution may not come earlier. But we wait for that. However, as prime institutions, I would think that each one of your institutions should eventually try to develop such infrastructure and facility at your own institution, where at least a few teachers can create these MOOCs, can run these MOOCs locally for some experiment and eventually contribute to the national effort. But that is a long-term activity. I will not, it's not included in this agenda. We come back to our agenda, although now it says only the formation of advisory board for the consortium and action agenda. But I would like to use this opportunity to clarify some of the points which were probably only partially answered during our long discussion. First and foremost, I would like to tell you that MOOCs is completely online activity and is asynchronous activity. There is nothing synchronous about MOOCs. When I release a MOOCs course, participants are welcome to do that course at their own free time, at their own pace. Since we impose a limitation of week by week schedule or a topic by topic schedule, generally we expect people to spend time in that week on that particular topic. But in that week, when an individual learner studies first videos, attempts these practice problems, etc., is entirely left to these individuals. So there is no synchronization. The only synchronized thing is if I am studying a MOOC course and if I get a doubt, in the discussion forum, I can raise that doubt immediately. When I raise that doubt immediately, the MOOCs operating team at IIT Bombay, which has these faculty members and a team of 8 to 10 teaching assistants who are employed for that purpose. And by the way, the discussion forum is practically watched 24/7. So, at night 12 o'clock, somebody asks a question, there is someone who watches that question. Need not necessarily answer it immediately. If there is a simple question, the TA answers it. The method is the TA drafts an answer, then it is discussed by the teachers, the wording is changed. The wording is very, very important of everything, of the discussion forum posts, questions, explanations, etc., and thorough checking is done. But the answer is posted immediately. One advantage of MOOCs, which is not found at all in conventional learning, is that some student asks a question and some other students respond. That is definitely permitted. Our TAs categorize that response immediately along with that. And sometimes the teachers endorse that response, saying it is better than what I could have explained. Now, that is the power of collaboration. And when you have thousands of people, such collaboration produces excellent material. So the discussion forum becomes the only interactive thing during that period. Now, in this context, I think you will feel the importance of these T10KT workshops. The T10KT workshops that we will conduct, as I said, simultaneously to these subjects are not only meaningful for our teachers, since they offer synchronous audio video interaction, and that is the reason why I wanted you to see what was happening in the environmental course. So, you will notice that we interacted with 4 or 5 centers, there are 100 such centers, but every person at every center is actually participating in that interaction. So, anybody asks a question, anybody answers it, that is how we run our T10KT workshop. The idea is that for these 52 institutions, we would like to make these T10KT workshops as an extended arm of our joint efforts to permit even students to attend these discussions. Now, when I said whether you will permit students to attend these sessions or not, some of you have said yes, some of you have said only teachers, some of you have said selected students, and then we had a discussion on that topic. We realized that my worry, suppose I am in a remote center, my worry will be as follows. It is primarily a workshop meant for teacher to teacher interaction. Now, in that interaction, I might ask a question. I might have to admit that I don't understand how this particular problem is solved. I would be a bit worried about my students seeing this interaction. So, therefore, I may not be very open about doing it. So, one suggestion which I vaguely mentioned in the morning, but which I extend now further is that, why can't we consider to have AVU sessions in 2 parts? In one short part, we will have interaction with the teachers. That is to ensure that the T10KT fundamental requirement of participation is satisfied. And of course, such questions are asked. Now, these question answers happen, during which time the local teachers can also advise that in my classes, people are asking this question or people are facing this problem, etc. And immediately following that, we could have a classroom session where the students can participate, where the local teacher can be present as a coordinator, and the students can interact with the MOOCs teachers here, giving the benefit of an audio-visual interconnect with 52 institutions. The only restriction will be whether you will have classrooms to accommodate if the number of students are more. But the AVU facility, we have seen that in some remote center today also, if there are 150 participants, we generally create 2 centers notionally in the same place in neighboring classroom. And there could be students assembled in one classroom, students assembled in second classroom, they are all interact. Now, if you think this facilitation is useful, then we will modify our thing to say that A, the T10KT workshops will happen and there will be a fortnightly discussion session between all the teachers. But we'll add now that immediately subsequent to such a discussion session, which may be of 1 hour duration, there would be a 2 hour duration interaction with the students doing that subject from each engineering college. Do you think it will make sense?
That came up earlier also, and is that perhaps, I mean, this may not be the right time to start it, there could be on certain days, like we have teacher hours. So, and different teachers could take this up. We could say from every Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 3 to 5, 5 to 7, some TA, teacher or TA will be there. Any student can log in from any institute and they can ask any questions. That way we can keep AVU open on those days something.
We can keep AVU open 24/7 because the AVU runs on our server here. That's not the point. The criticality is not the AVU availability. The criticality is availability of the faculty member in a synchronized fashion across 52 institutions and availability of our faculty members of that subject during that time. Please do not forget that teachers there as well as teachers here have other responsibilities allocated and associated. So, they can't be free at any point in time.
Correct, sir. Only some teachers need to be there, maybe.
Absolutely. If I even suggest this, Gaitonde will ask me to jump into Pavai Lake.
Okay.
You're saying, he says, Professor Patak, let me understand. You want me to attend to such interaction 3 times a week at the salary which is being paid by IIT Bombay to me to teach IIT Bombay students? It's a hard question. By the way, this is something that we all need to worry about. for the continuity, we all presume that while we continue to teach our courses, such MOOCs will be available perpetually. It is not guaranteed. When I offer a MOOC, today I am offering it as my personal interest and at the request of the institute. My primary responsibility is to teach courses which my head assigns. This work is not considered as part of my institute duty. Till such time that it happens, there is no future for MOOCs on a large scale. I have suggested to the ministry that each institution should be advised that just as they appoint teachers and allocate normal work, if any group of teachers work on an approved MOOCs to running the MOOCs, then that should be considered part and parcel of that institutional responsibility. Unless this happens, there is no incentive for a teacher, because enthusiasm can go for 1 year, for 2 years. For mad people like me, it can go for 10 years. But ultimately, all of us will take nirvana and do what is required to be done. So that's a larger problem. I'm mentioning it.
That is what is known as a PBAS, performance-based appraisal system. Because now everybody is doing according to that formula, that what gives how many points, this gives so many points. This gives, if teaching or attending MOOCs gives so many.
Well, if you are suggesting that I should ask my director that while evaluating IIT Bombay faculty members, they should give marks for the MOOCs. Unfortunately, Professor Gaitonde does not need any marks because, like me, he is also a professor on the verge of retirement.
Not IIT Bombay or professors here and there, but actually.
Jain Chandra. No, no. Okay. But we digress. I agree with you. But since all senior leaders are assembled here, I would strongly suggest that just like Dr. Nasa mentioned, that there will be a recognition of such innovations in the accreditation business. Similarly, can you consider while evaluating performance of your faculty to give a weightage to such innovative experiments in which people participate? I think that will go a long way in encouraging people. So I will go one step forward. Designing a MOOC and running a MOOC is a long-term thing and a big thing. But even participating in a blended MOOC program, please understand that if I am a teacher in your college, I have to actually spend extra time. First, I have to attend this additional workshop. Second, I have to understand how Gaitonde or others teach that course and blend my subject accordingly. Third, I have to supervise online examination, which I normally don't do. And I have to still continue teaching whatever I do. So there is an extra work that. Now, if the directors and vice chancellors could consider giving operation of a blended MOOC as some kind of a recognition, implicit or explicit, I think that will be useful going forward.
Can tell about that NIT system. So there is two components. One is desirable, another is eligibility. So that desirable component that is already there, that e-learning, any initiatives you have taken, so that will be considered as that point.
My dear friend, yes, such rules are very nice. They look very nice on paper, but they need to be implemented. And in order to implement, I actually don't need existing rules. We can make those rules. All that I'm suggesting is all of us should be aware of some positive contribution in this kind of recognition. Okay.
IIT Madras.
Yeah.
So our faculty, they attend the class as you have suggested, and IIT faculty conduct for the students, and it is directly communicated. But we are considering that load also as a part of their work.
Very good.
But enthusiasm is not maintained because it is not lucrative, or they are not getting anything as such. So if there is some kind of incentive if we conduct IITB remote center workshop, but in QEEE absolutely there is no such incentive. The faculty are not that much enthusiastic to me.
I do not know whether you are aware, but in a meeting with the RC coordinators for the T10KT workshops, we have said that we have to get out of the government funded model, and the self-funding model was discussed, where the participants will pay the fees for attending this. In a way, if your teacher is participating in blended MOOCs and we are running a T10KT workshop, that participant should be paying a fees to IIT Bombay to attend that workshop. So it is a minus negative incentive. For the time being, we are saying no cost to you, no cost to us. We will run it as a collaborative effort. Everybody takes care of one's cost. But let me tell you, this is another mindset change that we have to do things. How long will our young teachers continue to work only if there is an incentive? There is a human tendency, all right, but shouldn't teachers be taught or requested to think slightly about And what is a better incentive if the students who learn like this, 10 years later remember for you, you for actually helping them to understand something better? I think teacher ultimately lives on that incentive, but that is hypothetical for the practical.
Right, but we are taking it just like a blessing from Fatak sir right now, no, which is available.
Right now, what we ought to do is ensure that the blended MOOC experiment succeeds, ensure that a non-trivial component of the MOOC's marks are accorded recognition in your grade. As long as we achieve that for different proportions in different ways, whatever. So in that context, I'll come back to this question. Number one, MOOCs is completely online, completely asynchronous. The only synchronization that we said we will do is that when we open a quiz, the quiz is open to all participants, including your students, but we will announce the opening time to you ahead. And if you wish, you can supervise the conduct of the online exam for those students. If that can give you better credibility, you may then say that if 4 quizzes are such conducted in a supervised fashion, then I will get those marks and maybe allocate 30% weightage or 40% weightage, because these are like supervised exam. Instead of me setting the paper, somebody else has sent. That is perfectly fine. I would very much love to see that over this year itself, we slowly get a grip of what is happening and decide to enhance the weightage of the MOOC's marks that we give, number one. Number two, I will like to see that more and more participating teachers in these subjects actually start adopting the flipped classroom pedagogy and participate in active learning and introduction of more thinking to the students, because this is what will benefit the students ultimately. Now, having said that, is there any very specific problem which you think is a showstopper for running this experiment?
Hello. Before this, I would like to add something. As far as this blended MOOC courses that we are going to run, you are taking lot of efforts, and even the most of the autonomous institutes has started the credit transfer system, that the students are going from one institute to other institute, where the institutes are paying the tuition fees also. This is already, it has been started, and the institutions are charging 15,000, 20,000 rupees. But I am suggesting that if you are starting this blended MOOC, you ask for registration for a student and the institute will pay for that particular registration. You charge minimum whatever you feel, maybe 200 rupees, 500 rupees, whatever it may be.
Yes.
But this is going to have some recovery of the investment what you are going to do it. If you give it free, people will not
I cannot agree more with you with the observation that anything given free does not have a value.
Yeah.
I agree with you.
Yeah.
I also agree with you that eventually somebody will have to pay. There is no free lunch as the Americans say. Yeah. The point is, in our model, consider I offer this blended MOOCs and I say the university should pay, because university need not waste its time for conducting that examination. Equivalent of examination fees they should pay. I say college should pay. The college says, I am still required to teach that course. I am still required to pay the salary of that teacher. Why should I pay? The student should pay. The student says, I have paid you the fees. When I joined the program, you said this is the fees during which you will teach me for one semester. Now, who is this study? Suddenly blended MOOCs has come from where? I don't want it. You teach me normally. Of course, if you don't charge me, I will do that.
No, sir.
Please understand that charging is not an option which can be exercised by the decision in 2 hours by such a group. Charging is a decision which has to be taken after a lot of deliberations locally, publicly, etc., etc. What I said in the morning, you missed. I said we have to move to a self-sustaining model, and from next year, there will have to be cost involved in this. But there is a chicken and egg story. If I don't start this experiment, if students and teachers don't find it beneficial, then they will hesitate in starting. So that is why my suggestion was, and I think that is more or less endorsed by everybody, that for the first year, we will not charge anybody anything. But in the first year, we establish the methods, we establish the procedures, we establish the usefulness of this model. Let students also evaluate and see, oh, Last year, passing percentage in thermodynamics of my college was 55%. Now it has become 60%. Passing percentage is, of course, in your and my hands. In CS 101 course, I decide what is the passing marks. I announce 40% marks will pass. But do I fail everybody who get less than 40? No. I evaluate persons at 39, persons at 38, persons at 35. I evaluate after mid-sem. I tell all the people who score less than 40% marks up to mid-sem that you will be given a chance to appear for extra exam. Even if you score 100% there, your marks will be added to 40%. Now, don't we do all such things? We should do such things. We should be encouraged to do something, because passing and failing a student is not the main objective. In fact, our main objective is every student must pass. But in the context of blended MOOCs, it is our joint effort which will decide whether the blended MOOC experiment succeeds or not. One of the parameters I would like all of you to remember and discreetly tell your teachers, that watch out for the passing percentage of the students in that subject. Believe me, students will in the long term make their judgment on whether this is useful or not on this single statistical parameter. Implicitly, if the actually passing percentage improves, it will also mean that the learning has improved. That is how the passing percentage will be. So, we will go by this, we will not charge any money right now. Right now, there is a cost involved. Our decision which we had arrived earlier was that each institution bears the cost of conducting this experiment as far as that institution is concerned. Neither that institution pays anything to IIT Bombay nor IIT Bombay is in a position to offer any support for that activity. So I suppose that is okay, no? This understanding is okay? Yeah.
Largely depend on to what extent we would be able to flip it. Otherwise, yes. As a student, why should I take additional tax for the same 3 credits?
Correct.
Because a wise student will look has to take 5 courses.
So in that context,
for him, a course is a 3 credit.
Correct. So I would suggest the following. In that context, there is some discussion during the time in earlier that suppose I am teaching thermodynamics, but I find that the overlap of my syllabus and IIT syllabus is 25%. So, I will say these are the topics which are overlapped. I will of course ask all students to register for the MOOCs. But I will tell them that as far as this portion of the syllabus is concerned, you whenever it is being taught in that sequence, pay attention to it. During that time, I will run a flipped classroom and discuss problems pertaining to that particular portion. Give all the quizzes in that particular portion, maybe 2 out of 4 quizzes or whatever. And other portion of the MOOCs you may or may not take seriously, that is your choice. As far as my institute is concerned, I will give weightage to the marks that you obtain in these. Now, when the course ends, of course, the students would have scored some marks on the MOOCs. We will give you all these performance, including other performance in other things. You may decide to choose to only these 2 quizzes and take their marks for your counting. It is not as if MOOCs will give you 100 marks total and you are forced to take either 20 out of this or 10 out of this.
That problem of evaluation is rather, appears to be rather simple for us.
Correct.
So we can simply say that the all internal evaluation is from MOOCs and the external end same evaluation is the regular exam.
Yeah.
That can be
no, elicited. But there may be a squiggle like this. If there is truly only 25% overlap, then you may want to take only 25% of the internal marks from this. It is all up to you, I mean, it is entirely up to you. But considering the importance of flipped classroom that we have observed, which Professor Sridhar Iyer has been focusing always, do you think that in our T10KT workshop that we conduct, we actually conduct a couple of early sessions on how to do this flipped classroom and share our experiences, one. Second, would it be advisable for me to tell all my faculty colleagues of these 3 subjects to spend some time in every discussion session with the teachers that in your flipped classroom engagement on this topic, we suggest that you discuss these problems and these problems we are putting up on Moodle or wherever. We are also putting up the discussion that happened in our experience. and prepare teachers for conducting such an experiment? Do you think that will be meaningful?
Yeah, certainly.
So let us say explicit training on the flipped classroom methodology or pedagogy, and for every course, if flipped classroom sessions are to be conducted, then what examples should be discussed and what should be the solutions suggested, etc., etc., should be made part of the T10KT workshop for that subject. Agreed. That's a very good suggestion. It will improve the quality of teaching in learning.
More number of students are there, it will be a problem.
No problem. This is exactly the question which was asked to me. If more number of teachers are there, how do you run teachers training program? We are running it for 10,000 students. Suppose you have 500 students and you have 5 classrooms of 100 students each. All that you need to invest is a projector, a PC and an AVU client running there. You need internet bandwidth. If you have these 500 students can simultaneously participate in the student session that we are planning for actual interactive live session. I can say that with 52 institutions. If there are 500, Kamal will have to do some more work with larger team to enhance the AVU bandwidth. But supervising exams is another problem. Online exam, how do you supervise? We also had that problem. In the first time, we had only limited number of machines. So we used to divide people in batches and do that. One possibility which I have seen at least 2 institutions trying, they are not here, but they have 100 PCs in one computer science lab, 100 in IT, some 50 in mechanical and so on. So what they do is, if they want to conduct a synchronized online test for programming, they will commandeer all these machines, all these labs on a Sunday morning or on a Saturday morning when it is a holiday normal. And there will be a set of teachers and teaching associates who will supervise that online test during that time. If you wish to solve this problem, it is solvable. But I will tell you what happens many times, it happens even in IIT. Because logistics is very forbearing, I generally avoid taking that approach altogether. So I decide that I cannot conduct supervised online exams.
Exams we are doing on Moodle. So even on a mobile platform, they can just do. Our students are so rich, I mean all the students are so rich when it comes to gadgets.
I would like to love to teach in such an institution. My own students are unfortunately not all that rich. I'll tell you one experience. Last year when Professor Kavi Arya taught that course, he asked about 500 students in that class. He asked how many students do not have their own machines. 50 students raised their hands. So what we did is, Professor Kannan Mautgale has worked on the next version of Akash, that netbook kind of thing. So he gave them 50 of those machines. They are very lallu machines that way. 5,000 rupees, what do you get? No hard disk, no nothing. But it runs Ubuntu, it runs GCC compiler. So they were all happy compiling programs and learning from those machines. In fact, we had a case of reverse discrimination. 3 students came to us and they said, sir, we have high-end Apple computers. They run iOS, but they don't run GCC compiler. So we are being discriminated against. We cannot use these machines to learn this course. So they were given these 3 cheaper computers. Now, ideally, all our students, if they have computers, but please note, if you want to conduct an online test, you have to have internet available. If you run it from Moodle, you need only local area network bandwidth. Whereas for this, you will require internet bandwidth. In 5 years' time, every college, every lab will have people with their own machines and internet. We are talking about today. But these are decisions, my dear friends, which individual institutions can take based on their logistics and based on their requirement and based on what they feel is best. I would still strongly suggest that if you can succeed in conducting supervised online examination, then nothing like it, because that is going to be the order of the day in coming years. Whether we may be the early starters, so wherever we can, we should do it. There are multiple variations possible. If a quiz, and now going back to what Dr. Mogera had mentioned, we had said 4 quizzes. Now what prevents us from saying that we will actually run 8 quizzes, but we will take the best 4 marks of whichever are the best 4. And then for supervised exam, I will say students appear for 8 quizzes. Alternate quizzes will be supervised for some batches, alternate quizzes for some other batches. That's all. I mean, so many tricks you can do. You take home assignments. Are they supervised? No. But we give them marks, no? If they copy, we bash them. How can copying be caught in quizzes? How can copying be caught in programming assignments? What we propose to do, I am not guaranteeing it, but this is one of the requirement specification that we are given for the MIS reports. If from the submission of students of your batch, which you send us, 100 students, if there are identical answers to quizzes, we will flag that to you. Please remember, I am not saying correct answer, because I am a duffer and my friend is also a duffer. So both of us will identically give wrong answers, because I am copying from him. But as long as the answers are identical, there is a problem. That is how you catch copying, isn't it? So we can make such provisions for additional information. But I am saying that for such exceptional cases, let us not make general rules which will prevent us from exploiting this facility. We should deal with individual cases individually.
You have implemented these three courses in IIT Bombay. What's the weightage for MOOC you have given, number one? Number two is, per week, how many class hours and how many MOOC hours?
Okay. First of all, there is nothing like how many MOOCs hour or how many class hours. Class hours are defined by the timetable. Typically, we have a 2 hour or 3 hour per week classes. But wherever we have used MOOCs, we have not delivered lectures in any one of those classes. So I ran that course myself. Professor Sridhar Iyer ran CS101s like that. Professor Bhandarkar has run thermodynamics like that in a blended MOOC. In a blended MOOC mode, all learning or attending lectures is done online only. There is nothing like a MOOC hour. Students are supposed to see the lecture. Professor Kannan Moudgalya has been running the blended MOOCs for 5 years. He found that initially people were coming to the class without watching the video lecture. So he started conducting a quiz at the beginning of every class, and that quiz simply tested whether you have watched that video or not. But initially he said quiz will be conducted, even people did not take it very seriously. Next time he said there will be one mark for quiz in every lecture. Then everybody started watching in the middle. So the trick is you have to incentivize them to do that. So one, there is nothing like a MOOC lecture. There are lecture hours. And all lecture hours are spent in flip mode classroom. All assessment I had done online. So what is the weightage of MOOCs grades? 100%. I mean, there is no other exam. There is no other evaluation. Well, in our case, we did conduct an end semester on a paper exam. And that assessment was 30% weightage. So in my case, it was 70%. But as I said, IIT system gives complete flexibility for a teacher to decide. I would suggest that you go back and you advise your teachers to think about it and decide what they would like to see. In fact, if you are going to your academic bodies, and I am sure you will all go to your academic bodies, I think you should try and get a more generic resolution approved by the thing, that the exact percentage weightage to be given to MOOC's marks should be left to the judgment of the individual teachers, the nature of the individual subject, and it should be approved, let's say, by dean or somebody, but essentially give that freedom. Of course, if I were your Senate member, I would say this is fine, but to begin with, put some limit on top. So I might say, as a senator, it appears to me that if you are doing this first experiment, then allocate weightage anywhere between, say, 20% and 60% to MOOC's marks, not more than that. Now, this could be one particular way of approaching this, but individual subject, I would suggest don't straitjacket everything. Computer programming course is different in philosophy than a thermodynamics course, which is different from signals and systems course. Different subjects will have different flavor of evaluation and assessment. To say that every course will have exactly the same evaluation pattern, in my personal opinion, is detrimental. Effectively, that is why we have problems with the university system. No? Every subject has 100 marks, 20 marks are internal marks. 30 marks are mid-semester, 70 marks are end-semester. Now, we are working like that only. And look at what it has done to us. All of us think that allocating 20 marks to MOOC is the most straightforward, because nobody will question you. The problem is not that. The problem is we are worried that somebody will else will question me if I do anything with others. That philosophy has to be eradicated from our minds. I am teacher. How can anybody question unless my intention is bad and unless my execution is bad? In fact, I would like the partnering institutions to move towards that level of autonomy. But to begin with, in practical terms, I would strongly suggest that you go to your academic bodies with the explanation of this and get a generic resolution approved in your, sir, two NIT directors are there. I would like to request them, how do they see the possibility of their academic bodies reacting to such a suggestion?
No difficulty at all.
No difficulty.
Actually, we have resolved as a Senate chairman. Resolved it and accepted it. It will get ratified in the next Senate meeting. It's as simple as that.
As simple as
that. Just like your experience with your
dean. Correct, correct. So there is no issue. I think the problem will be with colleges which have academic autonomy but are affiliated to universities. And deemed universities which have for some reason adopted the conventional university structure for their evaluation.
Sir, is it possible and we can more to write email and for the suggestion so we can show that this is a, say, evidence from the experience and a highly respected teacher?
I will never ever do that for the simple reason that instead of taking decision on your own count, you are hiding behind a letter from someone else. Never ever do that. It is exactly the problem that we had in India all throughout. Unless MIT and Oxford and Stanford does something, we don't consider it useful. Why? It's not necessary. Each one of us can think of something good, something useful, and we should have the power and authority to say, we believe this is good. I would much like you to go and say, I don't care for FATEC or IIT or anything. I believe this is a good idea. And I have this much of paperwork, thoughts and processes defined to substantiate what I'm saying. Our problem is, taking somebody's letter is much simpler, but convincing someone with ideas will require hard work of several days and months to work out rules, regulations, processes and so on. Don't hesitate from doing that. Never ever do that. You may want to mention, and in fact, to help you, the letter from IIT will not help. But what will help is the minutes of this discussion, where 52 institutions of this country are joining in this experiment, and all of them have agreed to factor a certain percentage of MOOC's assessment in their final grade for that subject. All of them have agreed to experiment with this blended MOOC. All of them have agreed that their teachers will interact as a group of teachers jointly with IIT Bombay people to experiment new pedagogy such as flipped classroom. I hope you agree that if I write these things in a minute and circulate to that, to everyone. Don't you think that letter is far more powerful than one institution or one FATEC writing to you? I will tell you, I was so amazed. I mean, nowhere else in the world I have found 52 independent institutions coming together and joining hands to do this experiment. We are creating history, sir. Don't keep yourself aloof by letting someone dictate how you will create history. You be part of it.
Sir, I would say there were more than 100 who have joined, but lack of the awareness of this.
Yes.
There are definitely more than 100 who have joined.
Sir, I have only 100 autonomous institutions among my 350 remote centers. I have written only to 100. There are 400 autonomous institutions. But Dr. Mugera is very right. 52 people are starting this experiment. I will tell you, all the 100, 400 will be watching. AICT will be watching, everybody will be watching what is happening. And that is the reason why, more important than just defining rules and regulations, which we ought to do, far more important is actually conduct these programs for the benefit of our teachers and students. I would like in the month of November, if a TV channel goes to your college and interviews students and ask them, okay, you are doing normal courses like this. If you have done these courses in blended MOOCs, how you think it is different? It is your student who should say, we enjoyed these discussion sessions, we believe we learned something more, we find this more exciting, something like that. You get my point? NASA talked about outcome. That is the outcome that we want. Similarly, if the TV channel interviews your teacher, he is not present here. Technically, he is not a decision-making person. We are making decisions on his behalf. Now suppose I am such a teacher, I will give you two independent different reactions to such a TV channel question. I'll say, okay, I am a teacher in Agartala. So one possibility, one possible answer is, Malum nahi, Dr. Mugerai went there, he agreed for something, and he came and suddenly said, okay, you are doing so much work for teaching this subject, now you have to do double work. You have to attend this workshop, you have to do this, you have to do flipped classroom, whatever what. That is one reaction. The other reaction could be, I am so thrilled to have got this opportunity, I am so happy my director went and agreed for this. Not only my students, I also learned something new. We have discovered so many different new ways of teaching our students. Our students are more excited. The attendance in classroom has improved. Which of these reactions would we like to see? And that, implementing that, my dear friends, is our joint responsibility. Nothing else.
Sir, in NIT structure, we can introduce the MOOC's performance in their grade card also.
Very good.
In NIT, it is possible.
He is providing additional incentive without doing anything else. So, he can do that. But my dear friend, the problem with IITs and NITs is that they have so much freedom, which can be utilized to do so many good things without bothering about anything else. But I am worried about several of our colleagues here. I think deemed universities also would not have much problem. Could some friend of ours from a deemed university tell us? Yeah.
We do not have a problem. We can say whatever the syllabi we want.
Okay.
We don't have any problem in implementing.
Nothing.
Sir, we are autonomous of a Pune University.
Huh.
We just resolved that we left it to only to the faculty advisor.
Very good.
Faculty advisors can allow any course anywhere and we accept it.
I am worried about only the following possibility. I am an affiliated college, although I am autonomous, I take this decision, I go ahead. Technically, I may still have to inform the university that this is how I am conducting. No, no, your autonomy is different. There are grades of autonomy in India. There are some institutions which are so autonomous that every rule that they change has to be endorsed by the university. Now, if I am a vice chancellor in that university and let's say I have some khunnas against your institute, I say, ye natak nahi chalega, regular exam karo. That is my worry. So, but luckily, I don't think these 52 institutions have any problem, right? I mean, Madhav Engineering College is endorsing. In fact, RGPB Rajisa himself said that there is no problem with the institutes which are autonomous. So, I think we can go ahead. In fact, for all you know, this experiment will also help one more thing. It will help other institutions to become autonomous faster. I don't know whether you are aware of this, but there is a committee to review AICT under the chairmanship of they had called me for interaction, and I had said this fancy affiliation system has killed the initiative that a teacher can take. So I was told a very funny statistics. I did not know of it at all. My friend Dr. Uday Desai, director of IIT Hyderabad, a member of that committee, told me. He says, Professor Phatak, the affiliated college system, which have no autonomy, is practiced in only four great countries of the world. One is India, second is Pakistan, third is Bangladesh, and fourth is Sri Lanka. The British who introduced this system corrected themselves. Now their institutions are autonomous. But we have not only lived on that legacy, we have extended it further. If my institution was autonomous, I don't depend upon anybody else. As these people said, you go to your own senate, you go to your own academic body, get it approved and done. So, what the advisory committee is saying is, this nonsense must be scrapped, and they are giving 10 years to all institutions to either become completely autonomous and take responsibility for what you do or wind up. That is what their suggestion is for engineering colleges. Who knows, our experiment will actually strengthen that thing. Anyway, what I would like to show you is that we have anticipated some requirements of partnering institutions for information related to their students. So, Tushar, Mitali, and I forgot your name, Aditi, these three people, and I believe you have seen the summer interns working in the OSL. These are all students from colleges like yours. None of these three are from IIT Bombay. This entire system is being conceptualized and built by them. The summer interns will contribute a lot. In fact, they were very happy when I told, asked those students if you are from any one of these institutes, they said yes. So I said, when you go back to your institute after summer, if there is a problem in this MIS system, will you help your teachers? He said very proudly and happily, yes, I will do that. So this is something. In your kit, there are two documents that we have inserted. Both are work in progress sort of. The first document is about the use of IIT Bombay X. So the demo course that we talked about and how to use that interface. That material is also available on the site, but please use this yourselves to log into IIT Bombay X, enroll it and get some glimpse of an experience of how MOOCs learning is happening. You may need to spend about an hour or two over the next week or something. Then please advise all your teachers to join in on IIT Bombay X and to get that experience of how their students will be learning MOOCs. In any case, the T10KT workshop that will run simultaneously on the Moodle and on IIT Bombay X. There will be a corresponding course there. The second document which I have given is actually a what we call a software requirement specification, where if certain functionality is to be implemented by software, first we write what is the functional requirement. That document is about MIS system, that is management information system for teachers of participating institutes. So suppose I am a teacher in Agartala or COEP or something and I am a blended MOOCs course teacher. What I would like to see, if you are my dean or coordinator, program coordinator for the blended MOOCs in my college, what you would like to see and what head of the institution would like to see. This information requirement has been gathered. This is still work in progress. We are working like mad. We are sure that we will implement this system by July 15th. That means when the blended MOOC start operations, you will have, your teachers will have this information available to you. So let us see what that information is. If I am a coordinator at your place, say program coordinator in your college, I will choose this course and if I press a submit button, so CS101X is one of the courses. Once I select the course, these are the teachers who are teaching this course in my institute. So somebody said, I have 500 students, I might have 5 teachers. All these 5 teachers are teaching CS101. Each teacher has a batch of 100 students, 20 students, 30 students, whatever. If I click on any teacher, which one do you? So let me just choose this teacher. I click on this teacher. And I get in the coordinator's dashboard, I get the list of students who are associated with the batch of that teacher. So I am Puneet Patel. Fine. I am Puneet Patel. I have a total of 8 students. Now I have advised all those 8 students to register for IIT Bombay X, CS101X. I have collected their email IDs and sent it to IIT Bombay, saying these are my 8 students. IIT Bombay will immediately inform him that out of these 8 students, these 5 students are enrolled on IIT Bombay X, but these 3 students are not enrolled. So when this information, suppose I am Puneet Patel, I can ask my students in my next hour lecture that, Kaba, you have not enrolled for this course. Because without enrollment, how they will do the quizzes there and so on. So this is the first level interaction and in fact, this is the only input that is required by IIT Bombay from participating institutes. Namely, a list, what we call a comma separated value list, CSV format list, which your own local system administrator or even teachers can do, a spreadsheet saying this is my user, this is my ID from this college, my RC code or whatever, this is, and these are the students who are enrolled for thermodynamics or CS1. Once that list comes here, and that list need not be sent by email or something, because today we are only 52 people, but tomorrow there will be 500. So they are building an upload button. Once that person enrolls, there will be an upload button where I will upload all the students like this. Some student may join later, some student may leave. we will have a facility to modify that list. The teacher will not directly modify a database in our IIT Bombay X, but he will update that information. Once that information is updated, as I said, so this is what will be the, if I am Puneet Patel, or if I am a coordinator, coordinator can see this for all teachers, all courses. If I am Puneet Patel, when I log in, I will see only this, because I am teaching these people. If I click on any one student's thing, so there is somebody called B.M. Sharma, and what IIT Bombay X is doing is, on my dashboard, when I click that student's name, I will see the performance of that student up to whatever quizzes have been conducted. So this is the final, let's say, week 1 quiz, week 2 quiz, week 3 quiz, week 3 graded programming assignment. This was CS101. So there were total marks 6, he has obtained 3, 6, 4, 6, 5, whatever, these are the marks. The person has not given last 3 assignments, he has given only 2 assignments and he has scored these many marks, whatever. This is, by the way, real data from the students who enrolled for IIT Bombay X last year. And some of the remote centers had participated in this early experiment with blended MOOCs, where they sent us the students who are enrolled from their class, and we had sort of worked out on it. Now, do you agree that this will be useful for a teacher? So if only 2 quizzes are done, they will get 2 quiz marks. Not only that, let us go to the spreadsheet. This is, if I am a teacher, then I will get the performance of students in CS101X in a graphical form and for all students. Now, the only thing that we will not be able to do is, suppose one of the participating institutes decides that we will consider the marks of quiz 3 and quiz 4, another decides all quizzes, third decides all 100 marks. We will not be able to separate out these components and give, but we will give you marks for as many assignments or quizzes that student has worked online and got marks. And we will give them progressively, not only at the end. Week after week, you can get the progress. I hope that will be useful, because then, yeah.
Here, only the email address will be the.
Yes.
Sir, in the Moodle, we had a difficulty. Hmm. Give the first name as the roll number.
Yeah.
Real name as the second name.
Okay.
Then the advantage is, when I have to map the this marks, I have to map to my grade, no?
Right.
So there, I need the roll number and the name. First name is roll number, second
Now, this is where some of you are not related to computer science or information systems, may not appreciate it, but I think it is common sense. I store my information as roll number, name and marks, whereas this stupid system is storing information based on the email ID. And there is some problem. Now, this is the additional software development work that somebody in each institute will have to be done. I will tell you the difficulty in making a comprehensive software. First of all, the role numbering scheme is different in every institute. Some places you have the last name first or first name first. Some places you have the name and role number. Some places you have role number and name. Some places you have role number, name, hostel residence, room number, phone number. Of mother's name, father's name, whatever. What, these are different independent information. For the purposes of blended MOOCs, I suggest a simple mechanism. Depending upon whatever is your primary key of accessing that student's information, let's say roll number, you please ask all teachers to prepare first a simple table, roll number and email ID. IIT Bombay X recognizes people by email ID, and I'll tell you what I mentioned briefly. We respect privacy. Roll number is a very private information pertaining to you and your institution. It should not be made public. Even my name, Deepak Phatak, I may not like to be exposed to people. So on IIT Bombay X, when I register, I will give my email ID as dbp@it.iitb.ac.in, and I will give my some public name which I chose. Suppose I choose Abracadabra. Nobody will ever in life will see my email ID of IIT Bombay, nor Deepak Phatak. They will see only Abrakar. They won't know how old I am, what my profile is. This is respecting my privacy. Yes, if I ask a stupid question, I don't want to laugh at Deepak Phatak. Let them laugh at Abrakadam. Now, given this, how do we map it now to our requirement where student has to be identified? We are saying that this email ID is the only ID that by which we map people. So, in each of your institutions, you have a table for all the students, roll number and email ID. Now, whenever we send you this file, you can load it in a simple database table and ask your sysadmin or anybody, even your third year computer science students will be able to write a program for you. You take this table and convert all the marks, etc. for that roll number. You have your ready made. That is an extra work that will have to be done. And unfortunately, there is no financial assistance for that. That is your own issue. Yeah. But it's a good point that you mentioned. But you will agree that such a information will be useful? Okay. Now look at this dashboard. This just says enrolled students and unenrolled students. Means the following students are not say unenrolled, non-enrolled, whatever. Anyway. Now what will happen is, seeing this on a screen, whether for the coordinator at your place for all courses or for individual teacher is one thing. But eventually what I will have to do, I will have to announce these things in class. Now can I, need I use a piece of paper or take this printout or something? So for all such pertinent information, we are providing a download option. That means on the teacher's machine, the teacher can download these tables. Now the SRS document that we have given to you, it is not meant for you, of course, because it's some sort of technical thing. But I would request you to discuss that document or share that document, A, with the teachers who are teaching this course, and B, with the software professionals in your own respective institutions, to see what kind of additional software may be required to patch this information with, let's say, Moodle or whatever you, okay, or to build an independent. And if you can give us feedback in next 10 or 15 days, that in your opinion, this additional download facility or this format or this piece of information will be useful, we'll be very happy to do it. Of course, it's not something like frozen, but once we start operations, we would not like to change software till the semester is over. So this is just in a nutshell. So this is the login prompt. All the teachers must be registered on IIT Bombay X, as I said. This one. This is the screen for sort of selecting a particular course when you submit that. This is what I told you. But last time what we saw was the coordinator's dashboard. Remember that your director or head of the institution will nominate either the dean or some person as the program coordinator. Because you have two or three courses. For each course you might have multiple teachers. While we will be interacting with individual teachers based on subject to subject thing, but as an institution, there has to be one nominated person who will be responsible for it. That person we are calling the blended MOOCs coordinator in your institute. We will also have a similar person from our end. And these blended MOOC coordinators will resolve institutional issues. But the same information is available to individual teacher. So when I log in, I will get, let's say, this information. This is the student performance, which is week by week performance that I see. For visualization, I can click on a student and I can also get a graphical representation of the performance. I can also get overall performance as I just indicated. I can get a bar chart of what has been the performance of marks, etc. Usually as an individual teacher, I would like to follow the statistics to find out how my students are doing. This of course is reflecting only the MOOC's performance. Now this system we would be launching along with our T10KT workshops and the blended MOOCs. So do you think this will be useful, that download upload facility? There are no transactional thing, people will have only read only access. There are exactly two places where writing will occur, I mean transaction will occur. One, when you submit the list of students who are registered and any update there too. And second, when you download any information at your end. and this should be sufficient for you to. Only thing is, your teachers jointly with some software professionals might have to build some spreadsheets or Moodle or something like that to calculate your final grade. And final grade, as we have all agreed, is entirely left to individual institution, individual teacher, what percent of marks of which particular thing we have to give. Only thing that remains now is that if the institutions, I would not say if, because there are several institutions who have said that, that they would be interested in conducting supervised online examinations for at least some quizzes and some, for which the mechanism that we will follow is, as I mentioned, we will instruct all the course instructors that when they announce their timetable, they will announce the quiz starting time as this, which has been agreed upon by everybody, and that the participating teachers will actually conduct the supervised exam. We will not be able to maintain any information about supervision. When we give you the marks of these students, okay, there may be, for example, I am a student in a course and I actually decide to cheat, so I don't appear during that supervised exam. I go home and then work on the answers and give and get better marks. IIT Bombay X will give you my performance in those marks. It is for your teacher to say, "Arey Baba, you got these marks, but you were not here in that lab when that online exam was conducted. So these marks cannot be considered." Now this is a disciplinary matter that your institutions can do. Is this good enough to begin with for all of us? Great. So now we come to the final part. The final part is to request for, what should I say, nominations for being part of the advisory board. Of course, I have not taken a formal opinion, but let me formally move this resolution and let me see whether all of us accept it. Do you all agree that these 53 institutions, 52 people present here in IIT Bombay, form a consortium for doing this blended MOOC experiment?
Yes, sir.
Good. So we'll record it somewhere. Of course, we are recording the proceedings, so I will write the minutes later that we agreed to do this. Do you agree that the primary understanding of this consortium is to experiment with this blended MOOCs model to achieve two important objectives? First, significant improvement in the teaching learning process using modern technology and complementing our face-to-face teaching with MOOCs included. That is the first objective. Is that agreeable?
Yes.
That is the fundamental. The second objective is to ensure that the blended MOOCs is taken seriously by teachers and students. The participating institutions agree that a certain percentage of the performance of online evaluation will be taken as part of the final grade for the subject of that student.
Yes.
That is agreed? So these are the fundamental thing that we will write. Then we will, of course, in my minutes I will list that these three subjects are beginning with this. We should also agree, each institution agrees to nominate a program coordinator for the blended MOOCs, because director would be too busy a person, director has to run the institution. I would suggest even the dean could be too busy a person, but if a dean is willing to take this additional responsibility, there are only three subjects, it's perfectly fine. I would suggest that such a person should be a person with, let's say, substantial experience in running academic systems, some experience or something, but of course it is left to everyone. So in the minutes, if we write simply that each participating institution agrees to appoint a blended MOOC program coordinator who will interact with the corresponding coordinators of all other institutions to resolve any issues arising in the implementation. Is that
can the same person the RCC?
It doesn't matter. See, I'll tell you, if I am director of my institute, then I would not like a body to decide that I should appoint such and such person. I would, if I am a director of an institute, I would like the body to tell me that institution should appoint a coordinator. Now that decision is to be taken by the head of that institution. I don't think we are competent to enforce that. I hope you agree with that. That's the privilege of the institution.
Can you program coordinator?
It is entirely left to that institution. See, when institution head does it, institution head may want to look at various angles. How busy that person is, how passionate that person is about these things. Okay. So, let us not get into that. It's a administrative privilege of the participating institution. I think the joint body has no role to play in that. We can only say that there should be a program coordinator. Now, one second. Now we'll say every program coordinator will take the responsibility of conveying to the program coordinator at IIT Bombay the names, email IDs, etc. of the teachers who will be teaching any one of the offered courses, starting with three courses. So in our minutes, we'll say that we all agreed that we'll experiment with these three courses. So each participating program coordinator will convey which of the three subjects the participating institute wishes to experiment with and in which semester. So, for example, I am one of the institutes, I might say computer programming both semesters, thermodynamics semester 2, and signal and systems not this time, is my choice. So, you can decide based on your own timetable. Is that okay? We can record that in the minute. And then we will say that the program coordinator at IIT Bombay will ensure that T10KT workshops are set up for the benefit of the participants, and they will be run in each of these three subjects starting before the beginning of the semester and covering the entire duration of the semester. We'll just limit ourselves to that. We'll also make it incumbent on the program coordinators to resolve any implementation issues that come within the next month or month and a half related to starting time, ending time, online things, etc. And I think we'll keep that as simple as. Now, if we all agree to form a consortium, then it is incumbent that apart from taking these administrative decisions as per the minutes of the meeting that I will write, we should also have an advisory group, a group which will agree to spend slightly more time over the next year and more so in the initial 4 or 5 months to think about both the operational supervision of whatever we are doing plus long-term thinking and coming up with suggestions on how this model could be improved further. Do you agree that this advisory board, I am deliberately calling it advisory because then the implementation and the decision making can still be left to the program coordinators and individual institutions and participants. But I think whatever be the wording, I think all of us should agree in principle that all of us, either IIT Bombay or any institution, will generally go by the advice of this advisory board. We don't want to create a toothless tiger, right? The advisory board is effectively the spokes entity for the entire consortium. And I would like suggestions or what should I say, volunteers or something like that. My own expectation is that this group should be, say, something like 5 to 7 people with maybe 2 additional people from IIT Bombay. IIT Bombay, I have talked to my dean and director. So, our people will be the head of CD because he is the operational in charge of all operations here. And maybe I'll be there, Professor Sridhar Iyer will be there. But we would like 7 or 8 people. We will record that the advisory group shall consist of heads of the institutions or their nominees of the following institutions to begin with. We would request such a group to work for at least 1 year and then we will see how it evolves further. One of the tasks I would like to recommend to this advisory group is to formulate a multilateral memorandum of understanding. Once they do that, we'll circulate it by email or whatever and we could endorse it. And if there is going to be a meeting in September or October sometimes if somebody volunteers, then we can do that endorsement during that time. Meanwhile, all of us can individually take legal inputs, procedural inputs, internal validations, etc. So, any volunteers, first of all? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, my God, too many of them. So, let us look at the Indian geography. Gwalior is north.
NIT.
Yes, yes, we will have representatives of different things. SGSITS, that is not a good combination because both are institutions of great repute from the same state working under the same university. Okay, so just because Dr. Bhadauria is not here and Dr. Jain is here personally, I hope you don't mind, Mehta, if I say that we'll request him to participate. Okay. By the way, since we two know each other for 25 years, I have some other work meant for you specifically because I'm going to form another group. I will tell that group separately. It is more of an operational responsibility. So, I would like you to lead that group. I will come back to you. So, Jain Sahab, one is Gwalior, okay, north, northeast. Any substitute in case we lose you from NIT Agartala?
I will be there for 3 years, procedurally. You are my chairman.
No. Because I am your chairman, I am worried. Okay. God willing not. All right. But what we will do is, there have to be some NIT representative. So, we will say NIT Agartala and NIT Rourkela. Sarangi Sahib, you have any problems?
No problem.
And of course, you don't yourself have to participate, but heads of the institutions must be completely abreast with whatever is happening. So, I would ideally like heads of the institutions to actually consider meeting once or twice during the next 4 months. You may only in the worst case send your nominee or representative. It will not be your nominee, a representative. So let us come down. COEP. Do you have Sastrabuddha's permission to say that? Because it is the head of the institution who will be representative. No. Has he empowered you to nominate him to this particular? Yeah, because the advisory board consists of heads of these institutions. Fine. I cannot tell you why, but I am now more comfortable with both Anil Sastrabuddha and Gopal Mugerai both being there, because I foresee a danger of possibly losing one of them. Okay. COEP is there. No. The advisory board will consist of heads of these institutions in the first instance. What I said, nominee or representative is, in case the head of the institution is not available to attend a meeting of the advisory board, then that person may send the nominee. But I also said that 99% it should not happen. That means I would expect the head of the institution nominated to actually spend time, energy and mind to help all of us. See, please understand that once we form this advisory group, then this advisory group will actually be required to take a whole lot of decisions going forward, communicating with ministry later, expanding this further. Suppose, as Dr. Gopal Mugera says, 100 other institutions say we want to join. Now, what is the criteria we should put? So many things have to be done. So we have got three now. Let us travel geographically from India, Central India.
YCC.
Sorry?
YCC 1155.
What is Y?
Yashwantrao Chavan Project.
Yashwantrao Chavan. So, this is a university or a?
Autonomous institution affiliated to Nagpur.
Autonomous institution?
Affiliated to Nagpur University.
Affiliated to Nagpur University. So, your Nagpur University has no problem, no?
No, we do not have any problem. So, we have complete academic autonomy.
I would have ordinarily thought of VNIT with my friend Chaudhary there, but we already have two NITs. Third one.
NIT Nagpur.
But will Chaudhary be able to spend time? Last time I met him, he was cribbing that after he became director, he can spend enough time on research. Now, additionally, you put this, will he be able to spend time?
He will not come, he will nominate.
No. You are already anticipating that he will not have enough time. That is not true. By the way, I am very serious about it. This is a very important business. The advisory group is going to work on our behalf. They represent 52 institutions and they represent the burden of these 52 institutions in this experiment. So, are you sure that who is the head of the institution?
Dr.
Vaghe. Are you sure he is, since I do not know him, I would like to personally confirm with him. So, I will record this as a volunteer, but I will keep that on hold till I cross check. Right, thank you. We have come to the center, East Coast, Odisha, Andhra Pradesh, not coastal Andhra now, whatever you call it.
Geetham University, what is it?
Geetham University.
Yes.
Where are you located?
Hyderabad.
Telangana. Hyderabad is not Andhra Pradesh. Yeah. वो बहुत मारा मारी हो जाएगा उधर ओके
फ्रॉम तेलंगाना स्टेट
व्हिच
वीएनआर विज्ञान ज्योति
सो देयर आर मल्टीपल इंस्टीट्यूशंस
ऑटोनॉमस जेएनटी रिसर्च
ओके बिफोर गोइंग फर्दर आई वुड लाइक टू गेट वन और टू यूनिवर्सिटीज व्हिच आर डीम्ड यूनिवर्सिटी डीम्ड टू बी यूनिवर्सिटीज
यूनिवर्सिटी इट्स अ मल्टी subject
university. DAVV.
DAVV. One of the UP.
No. But be very careful because head of the institution of a university is vice chancellor. Will the vice chancellor be willing to spend time and energy on this issue? I am very clear on this. This is not something which can be delegated. If it is difficult, then I would suggest that we will not involve him on this thing, but we'll have some.
Sir, RGPV is Technical University of Madhya
Pradesh. Wow, RGPV itself. But will your vice chancellor have time to spend on this?
He's very much interested.
Very good. So I will say RGPV, but is a center and it's a university. But subject to your vice chancellor confirming that he will participate in this activity. Very good. Can we have one or two private universities? Because this is a government institution. I know you're keen on this. MIT is one that is in north. SRM is straight away in the heart of Tamil Nadu.
NMI.
Yeah, but
the head of the institution for engineering and technology is director, not because it's a multi-stream. We have medical, science and humanities and all. For engineering technology, the highest authority is director.
No, we have no problem. Our NITs are also directors, but they are equivalent to vice chancellors. So, in so far as the entire academic activity of the engineering portion is concerned.
Yes.
Syllabus, exam pattern, exam system, grading, degree giving.
Board of management.
Is pakka.
Yeah.
And who is the director?
Dr. Muthamizh Chelvan.
Dr.
Muthamizh Chelvan.
I can't pronounce it, but I will write the.
M-U-T-H-U.
No. But are you 100% sure that he will agree?
Yeah, sure. You can double check as you.
Who am I to double check?
No.
But I would like an endorsement from him.
Sure. I'll
saying that he has been briefed on everything that has happened here. So we'll take SRM as one institution.
Geetham Hyderabad.
Geetham University Hyderabad. Who is the vice chancellor?
We have director Prof. N. Sivaprasad, former AD Chennai.
Doctor? Geetham University, and this is Hyderabad. So SRM, I'm missing out on the count. No, one second. Five, I'll say SRM, and six, we said North India, we have Gwalior, Rourkela is. You have any suggestion? No, Jammu is one of the places. There is Vaishno Devi, Mata Vaishno Devi University, but they did not respond. No, that's okay. I think we can start with these five or six people. Anybody from Kerala or anybody from Karnataka? Okay. BMS. All right.
Kerala.
Amruta itself. Now, Amruta has multiple. But there is only one university. But your vice chancellor or chancellor is Amma herself. She will never have time to participate. Venkat will there. But will Venkat spend enough time?
Yeah, he is very interested.
My worry is that every time he comes and attends this meeting, he will remind me to collect 4.5 crores from ministry and give it to him. I can't do that now. Okay. So, is that okay? We write Amruta? Okay. No, it's not Amruta Kolam. It's.
But campuses, we have three campuses, three centers.
You give me the exact credentials. I saw Venkat sitting in Coimbatore, so I think it's Coimbatore. Okay. So let me just read out. One is Gwalior, second is Agartala, third is Rourkela, fourth is COEP, fifth possibly is that YC issue, sixth is RGPV, that is Bhopal University itself, seventh is SRM. 8th is Geetam, 9th is BMS. Am I missing something? 10th is Amruta, right? Okay, good.
NMMS or not, but we will contribute anyway.
My dear friend, each one of us have to contribute. Each one of us will have to contribute. No, this is, you can't have a 20 member advisory group for a 50 member community. It will look funny. Even these 10 are too many. We'll have two people from IIT Bombay. So I hope it is okay with you. By the way, we had scheduled the first meeting of the advisory board, but we need not have that advisory board meeting right now itself. If you permit me, I will discuss this with all the 10 people. I'll discuss this with my own, because I have not discussed with my director. I discussed with my dean. Of course, I know he will tell me you go ahead with whatever, because that freedom we have. But if you permit me, I will take these 10 names and 2 names from IIT Bombay, see my director, Professor Devan Kakkar, on Monday, and I'll consult him. And if he feels like pruning this, then I have your permission that one or two names so I can remove it if he feels there are too many. Otherwise, we'll have a 12-member advisory council. Rather than having first meeting here, I would now like volunteers from amongst these advisory board who are willing to offer conduct of the first meeting of the advisory board at their place, with each individual member spending money for his or her own travel to that place.
Agartala first.
Oh my God.
Take care of local hospitality.
Sir, you have no choice. There is no other place for hospitality in Agartala except your institute. If you don't take care of us, we'll go hungry. I stayed in one of the hotels there for 2 days, so I know the difference between the Agartala hospitality and elsewhere. BMS where? Bangalore. Bangalore is more centrally located. But would you have at least some guest house or something for these 12 people to come and?
No, guest house I can arrange.
Because while people will spend their own money for air travel, but they should not be required to stay under a tree in the night or something like that. Ideally, if there is an institution which has a guest house of some 12-15 people, that could be helpful.
Rourkela is on
the
excellent campus.
And I have 50-room guest house.
I see. I have a suggestion. It so happens that I am slated to visit Rourkela for an event, and I will be there on one day, I think 4th of August. Now, that event is in the afternoon or in the morning, sir?
Your choice.
No, no, your choice. The reason I was saying is that if it is agreeable, we could have the advisory council first meeting in Rourkela on 4th of August, say morning half or something. Then I can also be present there. If it is okay, Dr. Sarangi.
Yes, sir, it's fine.
It's fine. So 10 or 12 people will descend on you suddenly.
No problem. From railway station back to the railway station, all on our.
Good. Good. Okay. So that I will write down this option. So first option is Rourkela. The second option is COEP. Pune.
Again, same airport to airport, our
response. Airport to airport. Oh, you have guest house and all, is it? I had never seen one in COEP.
We have
nice places to stay, just close to.
So the second option is Pune, and third option is BMS College. BMS. All right. So if at all we decide on Rourkela, we'll do it on 4th of August. But my feeling is that one meeting we should have in July itself, before the semester begins. And the second immediate follow-up meeting, we should have in August. So is it all right to say that sometime in the first or second week of July, we shall have first meeting, which could be either in BMS or in College of Engineering Pune. And the second meeting we shall have on 7th of August in Rourkela. And these two meetings should be good enough to resolve all wrinkles for us to short. All right. Any other point that you would like to mention? I forgot to mention the second thing. There is also a requirement of continuously building information systems to back this endeavor. There is also a requirement to bring the blended MOOCs into the mainstream IIT Bombay X. In fact, Professor Avinash Aute did not like our way of doing things where we are building a separate MIS system. He had conceived the idea of a sister course, where in IIT Bombay X itself, the course is created for every partnering institution. Over the next 2 or 3 years, somehow we will have to implement such software systems in the IIT Bombay X. Over the next 2 to 3 years, each of the partnering institutions will have to build their own software internally to support the blended MOOCs operation. Now, for that, I would like a separate technical advisory group, which will be willing to study the IIT Bombay X architecture, which will be willing to study sample software systems implemented in different colleges. I believe Moodle is commonly used by many. This is not the community which can decide on such a membership. That is one of the reasons why I did not want Dr. Mehta to participate in that larger thing. Dr. Mehta also happens to be head of the computer science group there. He also happens to be a stalwart in variety of issues related to it. So if you agree, we will also minute that we decided to set up a technical committee to advise us on the issues related to software functionality, hardware, etc., etc. At the moment, we will agree that we nominate Dr. Mehta to head that technical committee, and I will request all participants to suggest names of individuals who are willing to contribute in terms of studying the entire software roadmap and making available their expertise to at least write something like detailed software requirement specification, monitor the information systems, advise on what additional thing is required, etc. Sorry, Dr. Mehta, I am taking decisions on your behalf, but are you okay with that?
Yes.
Wonderful. Okay. So please send some names like that. So all of you will have good software people, but they should be able to travel at least once in 2 months over the next 1 year. And they should be able to spend extra time on studying these things. Much of the studies, they will be able to do it there. And they could travel to either Indore, sometimes to Bombay or whatever. But that work is completely technical in nature. So, whosoever. Already from amongst ourselves, so there are enough computer science people amongst our own group. I did not realize. I will agree with that, provided your director does not give you the responsibility of being the program coordinator. This is so much of heavy work that you cannot wear multiple hats in this. It's be individual. But let us not force that decision now. We'll request that Dr. Mehta's email ID is with you. So anybody who feels that such and such person can participate, just write a small paragraph, a brief CV of that person, what that person's experience in information systems is, and send it to Dr. Mehta and me. And I hope you will permit us to select from, I am assuming that large number of nominations will come, we will select some group. But these people will have to spend an equal amount of time in analyzing the information systems requirement of this group. Okay. So, we agree that the first meeting shall be in July somewhere in between, middle of July or whatever, we will decide on the exact time, and that will be held either in Pune or BMS Bangalore. The second meeting will be held on 3rd of August, no, 4th of August in NIT Rourkela. And our first agenda should be to get a multilateral MOU to be sort of endorsed by us. So, I would request the advisory committee members to start applying their mind. I will initiate action in about 5 days of drafting a very, very crude form of a multilateral MOU, which I will circulate to all advisory council members, and they may want to look at it. One issue is also to select the chairman of the advisory group. So, we don't have any chairman. We have 8 or 10 names, out of which. So, what should we do is, I think we will wait for the first meeting, and in the first meeting, which is held in either COEP or BMS, when all the members join, we will ask everybody who can spend maximum time on this activity, and we will unanimously volunteer him to become the chairman. Is that okay? That is the standard method in IIT also. We unanimously volunteer somebody to do the dirty work. So, since there is unanimous decision, he cannot refuse. Our very good, very good. So, thank you very much for very, very meaningful participation. I will again repeat that the decisions that we have taken today are unique globally. There is no such body which has come together at a short notice and decided to try this blended move. And it is now incumbent on all of us to make this successful. If this blended model works, I tell you, history of not only this country but of the world will remember this. Already I am getting inquiries from Coursera, from EDX, how are you doing this blended model? The Russian university which is conducting EdCrest, when I told them that we are doing this, they said, will you please give a keynote and explain to us what could be the advantages. So, I heartily wrote to them that since your conference in September, I will not be speculative. I will tell you what have been the advantages. By September, we will know. So, I am being over enthusiastic perhaps, but I do not know. Let us see what happens. But I think if this large group is together, we can move heavens.